Hello everyone, my name is Aaron Gore and my talk today is about subsampling and knowledge distillation on adversarial examples, new techniques for deep learning based side channel evaluations. And this is joint work with Sven Jakob and Werner Schindler. So first of all, we develop a solution to the CHESS 2018 AIS challenge that can solve the challenge with just a single power trace. And the solution works by first using a deep neural network to extract some information on the key, and then using a SAT solver to solve for the actual key using this information. We compare this solution to two linear predictors, which we call baseline and ADF, as well as to a template attack, which was developed in 2019 by Dumm, Freud, and Klein. The ADF predictor is interesting insofar as it was trained on completely invented data, so on adversarial examples for the deep neural network, and insofar as it generalizes much better to the harder part of the AIS challenge than our baseline solution, which was trained on the real training data. And we think that this gives an interesting new method to gain some human usable knowledge from a deep neural network model for side channel analysis. And the code of our experiments is available on GitHub at the URL given. So the CHESS usually has a capture the flag challenge as a side event. In 2018, this was a side channel analysis challenge featuring DES, RSA, and AES implementations. The AIS challenge was a masked AIS software implementation with no details on the masking scheme being revealed. The traces were captured at fairly high resolution at 650,000 points per trace. There were three physical devices, A, B, and C, represented in the training and test data sets, each with 10,000 traces. So there were a total of 30,000 traces for training and 10,000 test traces, with the test traces having a fixed key and all being captured on device C. Then in the challenge phase, two challenges were released. One was a 1,000 trace challenge with a fixed key on device C, which was already represented in the training data set. And there was another challenge with 1,000 traces with a fixed key on an unknown device D. And this is the harder part of the AIS challenge. The challenge data was made available just prior to CHESS 2018 and the first correct solution to be submitted won. Since we didn't know anything about the masking scheme, it was difficult to attack the round function. However, we soon found strong evidence that the key schedule was unprotected, so we went for the key schedule. There are two previous published solutions to the CHESS 2018 AIS challenge. Both attacked the key schedule. First, there's our baseline solution, which we also explain in the paper. This is a linear model with L2 regularization followed by a subsolving stage. So this means we used a linear model and we forced the linear model to choose small coefficients. And there is also a template attack with a custom equation solving stage by Dumm, Freud, and Klein. Four other teams also recovered the AIS keys, but we do not know anything about their solution because they didn't publish anything about it. Then for the second part of our paper, the leakage attribution part, one relevant prior work is the paper published by Gera, Hetwer, and Gunesu in Transactions of Chess in 2019, where they studied three methods for leakage attribution for deep neural network-based side channel attacks. And among these methods were also the use of partial derivatives of the deep neural network with respect to the input data and occlusion experiments. And we use also occlusion experiments in our paper. And this strategy works for us fairly well. And we used adversarial examples for our deep neural network as part of our experiments in leakage attribution, and this is related to the partial derivatives method, because gradient descent is the standard method of gradient descent on the input data is one of the standard methods to derive adversarial examples for deep neural networks. So the basic design of our attack is it's a two-step attack. The first phase of our attack is predicting the Hamming weights of all 176 subkey bytes of the AIS key. This we do by machine learning, and then in phase two we use a subsolver to find the key by using this information plus the equation system given by the AIS key schedule. We develop three different attacks in our paper: the baseline attack, the ADF attack, and the deep neural network based attack. And these differ in the use of in the machine learning predictor used for the for phase one. The baseline attack uses a linear predictor trained on the original training data for phase one. The ADF attack uses the same kind of linear predictor as and the same training method as the baseline, but it uses different training data, namely adversarial examples for the deep neural network. And the deep neural network uses is the strongest of these attacks, because it has the best phase one predictor. So in the contest, we used a linear model. We first downsampled the traces to 65,000 points. Since we predict 176 Hamming weights, we get in total 176 times 65,000 parameters, which works out to roughly 11 million. This is a heavily underdetermined equation system, but with strong L2 regularization, we still obtained a model that achieves good generalization, even to the unknown device challenge. When we execute our model, we get a vector of floating point numbers, of 176 floating point numbers, and these are meant to be close to the Hamming weights. So to get something that we call a top two guess for the Hamming weight, we round these predictions up and down. So for instance, if we had a predicted Hamming weight of 3.78, we would make this into a condition of the Hamming weight is either 3 or 4. And this condition is then what we use in our equation system for the subsolver, for the subsolving stage. So there are some problems with this approach. The first problem is, what happens if some constraints are wrong? And we solve this by just randomly dropping some of our constraints. The second problem is, if our equation system is inconsistent, then our subsolver may take a long time to find out. And we solve this by imposing a resource limit on Crypto Minisat, so it stops trying after a fairly short time. And this means we don't waste a lot of time on trying to solve inconsistent constraint systems. But of course, this causes the problem that we might lose some consistent cases, and this is solved by just trying again. And with suitable settings on the resource limit and the dropout, we can achieve roughly 57% success rates given two traces at the unknown device challenge with the linear baseline solution. So for our deep neural network based solution, we use exactly the same pre and post processing. But our neural network extracts much better Hamming weight guesses than the baseline solution. However, each of the constraint systems that we obtain from our deep neural network solution contains a little bit less information than the constraint systems that are produced by the linear classifier. And therefore, while we get less errors, we have a bit more work to do in order to solve the resulting constraint systems. So most previous work on neural network-based side channel analysis uses network architectures that are inspired by the architectures used in tasks like image processing. In these domains, classification is largely translation invariant. However, this is a problematic assumption for power analysis because, let's say, you have a certain signal in a power trace that tells you that the Hamming weight of byte zero of your expanded AES key is 4, then if you shift this same signal a little bit to the left or to the right, if you shift this signal a little bit, then it might mean that suddenly byte 1 has Hamming weight 4. So the interpretation of a power signal is not necessarily translation invariant. And therefore, our network is instead built to exploit invariance under downsampling. So as an illustration of translation invariance, we can look at these two pictures. These are both pictures of ducks. And the pictures are actually the same, but the ducks are shifted a little bit to the left here. And for image recognition, we would expect the same classification for both pictures. We would expect both of them to be recognized as ducks. But as I said, for power analysis, this could be a problematic assumption. So instead, we use invariance under downsampling. So here we have again a picture of two ducks, and we have another picture of two ducks, which is downsampled, but we would still expect it to be recognized as a duck. And in side channel analysis, we would expect invariance under subsampling to hold, because subsampling might lose some information, but it should not change the meaning of the features. So in our final network architecture, we use a deep residual neural network that is a type of network that scales well with increasing network depths, because we wanted to also investigate whether increasing network depths will help us in improving the performance of our deep learning based side channel model. And our model does scale fairly well with increasing network depths, which is why we used in the end a fairly deep network. And then split the input into 100 subsampled traces that are each of size 650 points. We process all of these subsampled traces in approximately the same way. So we send these 100 subsampled traces each to 100 subnetworks, which share the same network weights and which have some communication between them so that they can share results, which helps them to improve their predictions. And at the very last layer of the network, we perform average pooling on the output of these 100 subnetworks to obtain a joint prediction for these 176 subkey bytes that we want to predict. So in the end, we get one vector of 176 floating point numbers, which we can then use just as in the baseline model to obtain our top two guesses, which are then used to solve the challenge. So we get a very good success rate with our deep neural network model, even if we use just a single power trace. This success rate is measured by counting which proportion of the unknown device challenge traces we can predict with 4 top 2 errors or less, because that is the largest number of top 2 errors that our dropout based error correction scheme can handle. And we see that the ADF predictor can also still solve a sizable part of the challenge traces just with a single trace, whereas the baseline model and the template model by Dumpf, Freud and Klein need 2 traces to achieve success in this sense in more than a single digit percentage of the cases. So while it is nice to be able to break an implementation, it is even better to be able to find and subsequently fix the sources of leakage. So to attribute leakage in a deep learning side channel model, we propose two new techniques. One is the study of adversarial perturbations. So we generate adversarial examples for the side channel model, which may be, for instance, change just a single just the prediction of a single sensitive variable. So let's say we could ask, what do I have to change in the trace to make the predicted Hamming weight of the first sub-key byte go up by one? And by looking at which parts of the trace we need to change to achieve this, we can see which part of the trace is responsible for the leakage that leads us to the recovery of the Hamming weight of the first sub-key byte. And the other techniques that we use is knowledge transfer from a deep neural network, where we use training on adversarial examples for the deep neural network, i.e. the techniques that we used to obtain the ADF predictor in order to transfer knowledge from the deep neural network to a linear model. And the linear model can then be leakage attribution for the linear model can then be done just by looking at the weights. So this is an example of this. These are the weights of our baseline solution in that relate to to a very early part of the traces. And we see that our baseline solution reacts to some very early part of the trace, both for byte 0 and byte 1. And if we look at the other sub-key bytes, we see that this is the case for all the first 16 sub-key bytes. So it's reasonable to assume that this is the effect of an unprotected key loading stage. So to extract similar information from our deep neural network, we use adversarial examples. And to illustrate adversarial examples, I've generated here one adversarial image for a deep learning image model that is called Inception V3. So on the left, we see the original picture. This is classified as a rake. And if you are like me, not a native speaker, not a native English speaker, you might have to look that up. I had to look that up. It means a male duck. So the classification by the deep neural network is spot on here. And the other image is a slightly changed version of that image. And if you feed the exact bitmap of this changed image to the same deep neural network, it will say with 99.95% probability that this is a triceratops, even though there is no perceptible difference between those two images to us. So adversarial examples, they are often just considered a bug of image models. But last year, there was a paper at NeurIPS 2019 by Elias et al. that showed that surprisingly strong image classifiers can be trained purely on adversarial examples. So they took the ImageNet database and they changed the labels and they changed the images adversarially to fit the changed labels. They trained image classifiers on these changed labels and found that these image classifiers still worked fairly well in classifying real images. This suggests that natural images have invisible features that can be used to classify them, which is a strange finding. So when we saw this result, we thought, well, image acquisition is a fairly complex process. For instance, there's always one intelligent entity involved in the acquisition of an image, namely the photographer who takes the image. And we thought that This fairly complex process in which data is produced in the image domain could possibly introduce various sources of non-robust features, of invisible features into images that could be used to classify them, and that are maybe not related to the objects that are to be classified in a natural way. And we therefore thought it would be interesting to try to reproduce this part of their work in our domain, because in our domain data generation is completely mechanized, and so there is much less uncertainty in whether there are some invisible hints in images that allow a deep neural network to classify an image by using features that are maybe introduced by the data acquisition process and not by the object to be classified. So we generated adversarial traces for our deep neural network, and we found that slightly changing our input traces, we can make our deep neural network model predict any AES key that we want. So we generated new random keys and changed all traces in the training database accordingly. Then we trained a linear predictor on this data and found that it leads a much better linear model than the baseline solution. And the weights of such a linear predictor are then roughly as interpretable as the baseline solution, but solve the side channel task under study better. So in conclusion, a combination of a deep neural network, a modern SAT solver, and a simple error correcting scheme can solve the CHESS 2018 AES challenge very efficiently with just a single trace. And adversarial examples can be a useful tool for examining what a deep neural network has learned about a vulnerable cryptographic implementation. And this concludes my talk. Thank you for your attention.